Yes, good morning, students. In last class, we have discussed about UDP stream communication in inter-process communication. In UDP stream communication, we have seen last class so many applications where UDP datagram communication will be used. Okay, after that, the next one is TCP stream communication. In today's class, we are going to discuss about the TCP stream communication. Okay, as all we know, the UDP uses the datagrams, TCP uses the stream communication. The major difference between TCP and UDP is TCP uses the sending order. The packets or the data arrives at a destination in a sending order. Whereas in UDP, the datagrams may reach at a destination at different time intervals, not in sending order. The first packet may reach third, the third packet may reach first, like that, and so on. Okay. Today we are going to start the TCP stream communication in inter-process communication. Okay. See here, topic is TCP stream communication. Okay, here in the TCP protocol, TCP and UDP are both protocols, right? TCP and UDP are both are transport layer protocols. Now, the TCP protocols, which originate from BSD 4.x Unix, provides abstraction of stream of bytes to which data may be written, from which data may be read. See here, before going to discuss this point, we need to understand and we need to know what is TCP and what are the characteristics of TCP. First, see, coming to the message size. I hope you student might remember about the problem with UDP stream communication is having a problem of 8 kilobytes at the receiving capacity. See here in this, what is the size of the message? See here, this application can choose how much data it writes to a stream or reads from it. It may deal in very small or very large sets of data. Okay, there is no limits for this. It may deal the TCP stream. It deals with small amount of data and as well as large amount of data. See here, that in this TCP stream communication, first it collects the data before it is transmitting to the receiver. Okay, first what it will do in the UDP, there is no collection of data. Okay, whatever the incoming data, that will be originated towards the destination in different routes. But the case is different. The TCP, that's what the sender will do is, the sender will collect all the data before transmitting, and those IP packets are transmitted over. Those IP packets are transmitted over the IP addresses. Okay, at the receiver side, on the arrival, the data is handed to the application as requested. Okay. This is the major difference between TCP stream communication and UDP datagram communication with respect to message sizes. It will deal with any amount of messages. There is no size limit and size bound. Okay. Next, lost of messages. In UDP datagram communication, there might be a possibility of lost of messages. Why? Because when coming to the reliability, TCP stream communication is more reliable than UDP datagram communication. As coming to the last messages, the TCP protocol uses an acknowledgement scheme. Okay, all we know about acknowledgement scheme. Acknowledgement scheme means for every sent data, the receiver must send an acknowledgement within a timeout. Okay, see, as an example of simple scheme, sending end keeps a record of each IP packet sent, and the receiving end acknowledges all the arrivals. See here we are having two ends. At the sending end, keep a record of each IP packet sent. The sender, what he will do, he will keep a record of each IP packet that was sent to the receiver. At the receiver end, what they will keep acknowledgments. They will keep all acknowledgments which have sent to the receivers. Okay. If the sender does not receive acknowledgement within a time limit, we know about this. These topics we have discussed in computer networks also. Okay. In acknowledgments and non-acknowledgement services in that. Okay. If the sender does not receive an acknowledgement within a given timeout, then what happens? Sender retransmit the same message. The sender thought of the IP packet got stuck, the IP packet not delivered to the receiver. Okay. Unless he gets an acknowledgement within a timeout. Here, in this, we have used a scheme of a sliding window that cuts down the number of acknowledgement messages required. We know about sliding window protocols. Okay. The sliding window protocol cuts down the acknowledgments. Here, in the TCP, we are using, listen carefully students, first point, in the TCP stream communication, we are using an acknowledgement scheme, right? Okay, here, whatever the data sending and acknowledgement sending, both we need a connection, okay? Both sending a data is a transaction, sending an acknowledgement is a transaction, okay? But channel utilization for a small amount of message. Acknowledgement is a very small in size, right? The data is very big in size, right? So for this sliding window protocol, what it will do, it will introduce a concept of piggybacking. Okay, instead of sending an acknowledgement, what the receiver will do is, the receiver sends an acknowledgement along with the data. Okay. Along with the data, this reduces the number of transactions and number of acknowledgments. Okay. Next one, flow control. Here, flow control means this is the response. Normally, when computer networks coming to the networks, this is the responsibility of the data link layer. Here the concept of flow control is sender sending rate and receiver receiving rate both needs to be synchronized. Okay, the transmission rates of sender and the receiving rate of receiver must be synchronized. Here in the TCP protocol, attempts to match the speeds of processes that read from and write to a stream. Okay, read from and write to a stream. Then the speeds must be matched. If the writer is too fast for the sender at the for the reader, then it is blocked until the reader has consumed the sufficient data. Here, even though the writer is too fast, he needs to be fast for the reader, then it is blocked until the reader has consumed the sufficient data. Here, the concept is the synchronization. Okay, we need to match the speed of reader and writer as well. Next one, message duplication and ordering. Here, message duplication means same data will be transmitted again and again. Here, the message, who will identify this? The message identifier are associated with each IP packets. The message identifier are associated with each IP packet, which enables the recipient to detect and reject the duplicates. This message identifier at the receiver identifies the duplicate packets, and it will detect the duplicate packets, and it will delete the, it will reject the duplicate packets, or the reorder messages that do not arrive at the send order. Here, message ordering. To reorder messages, that do not arrive in sender order, reorder, what not normal order. Reorder means whenever the data is having a problem that needs to be transmitted again. Okay, that will not follow. That will not follow in the sender order. Okay, normal TCP stream communication will follow. Suppose I have sent a 10 packets, packet 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on, packet 10. Those 1 to 10 will arrives at the destination in a sending order, but whatever the packet is having problem, suppose the packet 3 is having problem, it doesn't get an acknowledgement within a timeout, it needs to be transmitted again. That will not follow the order, it will not follow the sending order. That is what they are mentioning here. Next one, message destinations. Here, once the communication between the pair of processes, once the communication connection between pair of processes is established, all the processes simply read from and write to the stream. Here, this is a three-way handshaking method. TCP is nothing but three-way handshaking method. Three-way handshaking method, in the first way, connection establishment. In the second way, the data transfer. In the third step, the connection release. Here, once the connection has been established between the pair of processes, the processes simply read from and write to the given stream. Next one. Coming to the TCP abstractions, here the data abstraction of a stream, the data is abstraction of stream of bytes, and a connection is established before the messages are sent. As I told you, the second point, students, which one I will highlight you? This one, this particular one. A connection is established before messages are sent. As I told you, first we need to establish a connection. That is the first step. After the connection establishment only, the messages are to be sent. Here, it assumes one process is the client and one process is the server in establishing a connection. Here, in the establishment of a connection between two processes, one process is assumed to be a client and one process is assumed to be a server. Here, for client and server relationship, what we need to have for the communication, we need to have a socket bound between the client machine and server machine. Here, see here the next point. Here, what the client will do, the client create a socket bound to any local port and makes a connect request for the connecting the server as its server port. First, the client creates a socket bound to any local port. We have seen in the UDP stream communication, what is local port and what is socket, right? We have seen this particular topic in UDP peer-to-peer communication also. Okay. Next, after creating a socket bound, what the server will do is, the server creates a listening socket bound. What the server will create? Client create a socket bound to any local port. The server will create a listening socket bound to a server port and wait for accept the incoming requests. Incoming requests from the client. Here, the messages are sent using handles. As we know, the messages got exchanged through sockets rather than source and destination addresses. Once the client and client machine and server machine got bounded with sockets, all the messages will be exchanged between client and server, not with the addresses, with the source address and destination addresses, with the sockets. Here, an application closes a socket once it is done with the transmission. Here, once the transmission is completed, the socket will be closed. Okay, these are the TCP abstractions. Next, moving down to the issues with the, we have some issues with UDP communication also, like that here also some issues with TCP stream communication. See, students, here we have some issues with TCP stream communication. First one is matching of data items. Here, matching of data items means two communicating processes needs to agree on contents of transmitted data. Contents of transmitted data means we need to know sending data and received data should be matched. So the two communicating processes needs to be agree among this upon this. Next one, blocking. The next issue is blocking. Here, when a process try to read data from input channel, it will get the data or block until the data is available. See here, when the blocking will be done, when a process tries to read the data from input channel, it will get the data if it is free, or it block until the data is available. This is called blocking. Okay. Next, thread. When a server accepts a connection from the client, it generally creates a new thread for the new client. These are the issues with the TCP stream communication. Coming to the failure model. TCP, we know students, we know TCP meant for reliable communication. Why? Because the data transmitted through TCP is in the form of stream, and it will arrive at the destination, and it will use the acknowledgements also. So it is said to be reliable communication. Here, see, the TCP uses three mechanisms for to create a reliable communication. See, what are those? Checksums and sequence number for integrity. See, we know checksum. What is the meaning of checksum? And what is the integrity? See, what is the relationship between checksum and integrity? This is very simple, students. In computer networks, we have seen the importance of checksum. Checksum, how we will calculate the checksum? Suppose the given data is divided into segments, right? Those segments to be added, the addition should be ones complement arithmetic addition. After that, we will get a sum. For that sum, we need to do the bitwise complement. We will get a checksum. Okay, along with the data segments, the checksum segment also will be also sent to the receiver. The receiver will do the same, ones complement arithmetic addition to the all segments. After that, he will get a sum. After complementing that sum, he will get some value. That value is all zeros. Then the data is integrity. The data remains integrity. Okay. While it will deal, if the receiver got non-zero values, okay, the bits might be modified during the transmission. This is the relationship between the checksum and integrity. And what is the use of sequence numbers? Here, the sequence number is to detect the reject the duplicate packet. Suppose the packet is having sequence number one, that again will reach, that is already arrived at the destination, that will be sent again. The receiver will not accept with the sequence number one again. Why? Because it will not accept the duplicates. Okay, this is the use of sequence numbers and checksum. Okay, next one, limit. Next one is, this is the first model which is used for reliable communication. Second one is timeouts. Here, the timeouts and retransmission related to each other. Here, TCP stream communication uses an acknowledgement scheme. After sending the data, the sender will expect an acknowledgement within a timeout. Within a timeout, the sender needs to get an acknowledgement from the receiver. Okay. Otherwise, it will retransmit the same packets. See here about timeouts and retransmission for validity. TCP stream uses timeouts and retransmissions to deal with the lost packets. Okay. Here, see, the problem is if the network becomes congested. I'm saying about timeouts. Not this is not the third one. I'm saying about the timeout. See, I am a sender, you are a receiver. I sent a packet to you. We both are connected in TCP connection. Within a timeout, I need to get acknowledgement from you. But due to network congestion, the acknowledgement will reaches to the sender late. Why? Because it reaches to the destination late due to the network congestion. Okay. And what happens? This is the problem with timeouts. This is the problem with timeouts and retransmission. Next one, last one. When a connection is broken, it will has the following effects. Once the what I told you, first we need to establish a connection. After that, data transmission, connection release. Here in between the communication, when a connection is broken, the process using the connection cannot distinguish between network failure and failure of the process. Okay. Here the communication process cannot tell whether the recent messages have been received or not. Why? Because already the communicating process sent messages. Before receiving an acknowledgement, the communication got broken. The connection got broken between the sender and receiver. But here, the process does not guarantee whether the messages are reached to the destination or not. Okay. Here, our challenge is the programmers needs to deal with this type of situation. Okay. These three are the issues. First one is checksum and integrity. Second one is timeout. Third one is connection broke. And coming to the applications of applications of TCP. First one, HTTP. All we know about HTTP meant for hypertext transmission protocol. This will be used for communication between web browser and web servers. Okay. Web browser and web servers. Web browser means Mozilla, Firefox, Internet Explorer, Chrome. Web servers means servers. Okay. In the web browser, what we will give, we'll give the URLs and addresses that will contact to the, that information will reach us to the server by using HTTP. Next, FTP means file transfer protocol. This FTP allows directories on your remote computer to be browsed. Next, SMTP, so Telnet. Telnet also we have. This Telnet provides an access by means of a terminal session on your remote computer. Suppose I need to access your computer by using Telnet protocol, it will be possible. I can take an access, remote access to your computer by using Telnet. SMTP, this is simple mail transfer protocol, is used to send the messages between computers. Next, DNS. DNS means two types, domain name system, domain name space. Here, the DNS is domain name space. This domain name space is having, like UDP also, deals with this DNS, and coming to the TCP, it is also an application of this one. DNS, what it will do is DNS containing so many domain names and located and translated into internet protocol addresses. Suppose whenever we type an address of www.gmail.com, that will be converted to an IP address and it will reach us to the Gmail server. This is what DNS meant for. Next, NNTP, Network News Transfer Protocol. It is a new protocol. Till now, we have seen FTP, we have seen HTTP, all this NNTP is a new one. This is a Network News Transfer Protocol. which is the predominant protocol used by computer clients and servers for managing nodes hosted on Usenet news groups. Okay, this is the protocol which is used to note down the news groups. Next one, network file system. Here, the network file system is a client server application that lets computer user view and optionally store update file on a remote computer as though they were in the user's own computer. See, it is a client server application, network file system, that lets the computer user, that means user, view optionally to store the updated file on a remote computer or as though they were in user own computer. Okay, even though he is using a own computer, he can save the information in the remote computer also. Next, last one, ONC, open network computing. Here it is sometimes referred as SunRPC, that is one type of remote procedural call, was one of the first commercial implementation of RRPC. Okay, see here, this is the TCP stream communicating environment. See here, I told you first we need to establish two processes needs to be communicated. One is assumed to be client. This is very, very important diagram. One is assumed to be client and one is assumed to be server. First, we have a socket. First, we have a socket. The socket needs to establish between client and server. See here, first, this is the socket at the client. This is socket at the server. First, the binding should be done between the client and server. After that, he will listen the client. See here, socket, this socket connection, these two are see my mouse cursor point. This is the socket and this is the socket. This is the client socket and this is the server socket. And after the socket, it needs to be bind the client. And after that, after the binding has been done. Binding means the connection establishment has been done between the client and server. The server will listen the client and whatever the process, it will accept the connection acceptance has been done here. The connection should be accepted here. This is the three-way handshaking method. Here they mentioned TCP three-way handshaking method. Okay. This process should be blocked until the client connects. Next, once the connection has been established, what they will do? Read from and write to. Okay, the client will read from the server and write to server. Read from server, write to server. Server read from the client, write to client. And once the transactions read-write operations has been completed, release the resources. First, see students, I'm repeating once again. Why I mentioned here TCP client and server, as I told you in the earlier, two processes wants to communicate. One needs to be assumed as TCP client. One needs to be assumed as TCP server. First, we need to get a connection by using socket. In TCP, instead of using IP addresses, port numbers, they will use as sockets. Okay, once the socket is established, it will bind. Once the binding has been done, it will listen the clients. Till this client connects to the server, it will block until the server will block and it will accept the connection request from the client. And this is after connection has been established, the client and server will do read from and write to operations. Once these operations got completed, release the resources by using the close. Okay. This is about TCP stream communication. In last class, we have seen UDP stream communication. This is the TCP stream communication. Yes, you will go through this program. This is a two programs here we have in Java. The one is TCP client program and TCP server program. Just you can understand, I will send you. Okay, in the next class, we'll discuss about the external data representation and marshalling. Thank you, students. That's it for today.